The last time we saw the ZX Spectrum Plus 3, I had managed to accidentally fix the keyboard. Well, today I'm going to show you how I did it and hopefully fix the rest of the machine and get it back in full working order. My name is JSB, this is my tech department. Los Gates. Now, it won't have escaped your attention that we are sponsored by PCBWay, but what makes PCBWay so special? Well, let's take a look. For example, the replacement ROM PCB for this Atari 800XL, well, I got it made by PCBWay. But PCBWay do, well, way more than PCBs. For example, when it comes time to remake this panel for a project that's coming up later this year, well, I'll be looking at PCBWay to do the milling. In fact, if you've got a project on the go, chances are PCBWay can help you out. From 3D printing to CNCing to full fabrication. PCBWay, way more than just PCBs. For more information, check out the link in the description below. So where to begin? Well, it turns out you don't need the keyboard in place to check if the keyboard is working. You can see we have keyboard Y and keyboard X. These are our keyboard connectors. And by bridging the pins, I can tell if the ULA is receiving the right information. Now, why keyboard Y and keyboard X? Well, the keyboards work on a matrix system, which is essentially a map that tells the ULA which key is in which position. So, for example, if I bridge pin 1 on keyboard Y and bridge 1 on keyboard X, well, actually, I get the number 1, and that's the key that's assigned to that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bridge pin 11 on keyboard Y and pin 12 on keyboard X to bring down the arrow key. That will activate my arrow key and hopefully I can get it down the screen with nothing else interfering and get us into 48K basic. Then I can plug the keyboard back in and see what keys are actually working. Of course, before that, I should actually just trim down the ends on these little tabs here because they had become a bit worn. So that's what I did. And that's where I noticed suddenly one connector with our enter key started working. Lo and behold, it actually worked and I was able to get down into 48K basic. Plugging the keyboard back in though, this is what I found. Symbols. Lots and lots of symbols. It turns out one of the symbol shift keys is stuck. So let's fix that. And believe it or not, that's actually quite simple. Well, to fix the problem, what I had to do was remove the membrane, give it a gentle clean because dust was everywhere, and then do something that was both tricky and easy at the same time. So it turns out the ZX Spectrum Plus range has two symbol shift keys, one on the bottom left and one on the bottom right. To fix my issue, I gently peeled apart the two layers of the membrane, just gently to lift it off and hopefully disconnect the keys. And that was it. The keyboard actually just started working perfectly after that. So, yay! With membrane back in place and our keyboard reassembled, let's do a quick test and see if it works. And you can tell by that sound, it works fine. So no more stuck caps lock or stuck symbol shift. We can now move on to other problems on this board. But to get that working again is a huge win. With the keyboard back in action and expectedly, I can actually turn my attention to the disk drive. Now, I already know this is broken. These 3-inch drives have a reputation for dissolving drive belts. And, well, it's been 30 plus years, so it wouldn't shock me if that's the case here. To get at it, I need to remove this main board. And although it looks easy with just 3 screws holding in place, it's anything but. The truth is, you will have to undo the 3 screws and remove a few plugs as well. And even then, you won't be able to get the board out easily, at least not for what I need to do. Instead, you'll have to remove 2 or 4 cables that are directly soldered to the board. And this is a bit of a pain because they're not easy to solder back in. Let me demonstrate. So here you can see this orange and yellow cable, they're soldered into the board. And well, getting at them is difficult. Turning to our drive, yep, as I expected, the belt has long since perished and yeah, it's stuck to this main drive spindle. Now, for the most part, it just peels off. Look at it, it's just disgusting. But when I get to the drive spindle that controls the motor, well, it's a bit of a different matter, actually. Yes, where the belt has been sat, it's actually become corroded around the drive spindle, little drive spindle there. Look at it. It's really stuck, and peeling it off, well, it's reacted with the brass, so it's making it a little more difficult. Plenty of IPA helps clean it up, but there is a little flat spot left on that wheel. Hopefully that's not going to be a problem. So fitting the new drive belt though is easy. Place it around the big wheel, put it on the small wheel, and well, that's it actually, it's just done. One final thing to keep an eye on is the right protect pin. Without it, the drive cannot write a new disc. The pin is only sitting in that spot loose, and if you turn the drive upside down, it'll fall out and disappear. So be careful and keep an eye on it. Next, we turn to the missing audio connector. And as it turns out, whoever removed it beforehand had burnt off the pads on two of the top parts of the board, one of which heads with a trace to the RF modulator. Fortunately, we don't need the audio to the RF modulator. We're going to be using RGB, so it's not a problem, but still, it's a bit of a shame. Hopefully it'll work fine. At this point, I decided it was good time to test the machine. So I quickly reassembled it to as limited a space as possible and checked out whether it would load a game. Unfortunately, what also happened was that my microphone decided to run out of battery at that point, leaving me relying on the headphones I was wearing for a microphone, and the sound quality was atrocious. Nonetheless, I put a game in the drive, hit loader, and wouldn't you know it, it actually loaded the game from the disc. What follows though is me trying to explain that the sound quality on this machine is very poor because it's an Amstrad issue 1 plus 3 board, and they screwed up the audio circuitry, which meant that the AY3 chip, the Yamaha AY3 chip, its output is too high, so the sound distorts. There is a fix for it, which we're about to do, but unfortunately I have no audio showing how bad the audio was in the first place. Mental note, check next time that your microphone is fully charged. Idiot. Now, to do this mod is actually fairly simple. It just involves removing a set amount of resistors, changing them for different values, and then adding two extra resistors to the board. The most difficult of which is the one that goes between one leg of a transistor, TR5, and back to the board, and I'll show you that now. Yet the most difficult part of this mod is getting that transistor leg out, pointing it up, then putting the new resistor leg in there before attaching the other end of the resistor to the transistor leg that you've just pulled out. Now, I've added a little bit of heat shrink here to help cover things up and make sure nothing shorts, but there's plenty of room under the case and this is not a problem. Finally, one more resistor to go, and that just attaches to the underside of the case. It's easy to do. There's only two points to solder up and they're very close to each other. So once this is done, that's our modification done, full stop. If you're interested in carrying out this modification yourself, well, I'll put a link in the description below to Spectrum for Everyone, where I discovered this tutorial. And yeah, it's excellently laid out with individual pictures showing which resistors need to be changed and for what values, and with plenty of advice how to achieve, well, this. Once it's all done, however, let's get the machine back together and see if it's made a difference to our audio. And hopefully, I've recorded it with a better microphone this time. Idiot. With the computer back together, let's see if our improvements have worked. So, loader. Our drive is spinning, it's flashing. And patting short is loading. Is our music any better? That... it's a very good question. And yes, I think so. Although I did forget to take out one capacitor, I forgot to take out C37. So maybe I'd make that change, but in general, yes, it's improved, much improved. Before we look at our finished ZX Spectrum Plus 3, let's take a look back and see what we started with. And it wasn't a pretty picture. as ZX Spectrum Plus 3 had been neglected. It had a sticker stuck on top of the 128K, which I was all but certain was going to ruin the sticker underneath. The case was damaged, and even the audio jack at the back, well, mangled and broken. A damaged keyboard membrane almost rendered this machine completely useless, but fortunately, it just needed a little cleaning and lifting up of one button underneath. Our disk drive was broken, well, the drive belt had disintegrated and needed cleaning properly before we could add a new drive belt and get the machine back in working order. Finally, we sorted out the audio circuit, which was incorrectly created at the factory, giving us better audio and a better experience all around. With all that then, all we had to do was reassemble the machine and see if it worked, and lo and behold, it did. So what does our ZX Spectrum Plus 3 look like now? Well, let's take a look. The Sinclair ZX Spectrum Plus 3 128K machine, well, that was the last hurrah for the ZX Spectrum name, unfortunately. As the 16-bit revolution took hold, Amstrad and by extension Sinclair, well, they fell by the wayside. We would get one more Sinclair branded machine, the ill-fated PC200, a sort of desktop PC meets word processor that, well, didn't really do much of either, to be honest with you. However, the Plus 3, well, it's a wonderful machine, and I'm so happy to have this one fixed back up and working. Now, there are always jobs to do, like painting up the Spectrum name here, but the machine is cleaned, and whilst it's not pristine, it's probably good for another 30 years, which frankly is more than I can say for myself at this point. Either way, let's just marvel at the ZX Spectrum for a little while before we get to our outro. I think it deserves that, don't you? And there we have it. The ZX Spectrum Plus 3 is back together and, well, working perfectly. Considering that keyboard could have spelt the end of this machine, it's amazing that all it was a little bit of a sticking membrane that was causing a simple shift key to stick. Add to that, changing our drive belt in our disk drive and just giving it the tiniest of cleans has brought it back to full working order. Finally, we changed out part of the circuit on this machine to bring the audio back to something normal and found in the ZX Spectrum 2B. What's really amazing to me is that whilst this machine is not a looker, it does have dings and scratches, it's still working. Even after its creation in the late 80s, it's still working and still able to be used. And that is, well, fantastic. It's a testament really to how well Amstrad managed to build these machines, mistakes with audio notwithstanding. All that's left to say now is thank you so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed this video. I do appreciate your support. Sound works perfectly. And all that's left to say is when it comes to old computers, remember to reuse, rediscover, and you never know. You might find your own Sinclair ZX Spectrum Plus 3 just waiting for a little TLC to fix a tiny little key that'll bring it back to the land of the living. My name is Jespy. This has been my tech department. Cheers.